when Square Enix showed off a technical demo of what Final Fantasy VII might look like on Sony's PS3 at E3 2005, there was a massive reaction from the viewing audience. Many people made rumors that Final Fantasy VII Remake on the PS3 was going to happen. In actuality, what the Final Fantasy VII tech demo staff worked on was a prequel to Final Fantasy VII, a PSP exclusive title called Crisis Core Final Fantasy VII. This fact is made evident when watching the CGI cutscenes featured in Crisis Core, because they pretty much look like that. The CGI graphics is probably the best part of the game. It's amazingly detailed and entertaining, and the way it progresses the plot of the game is mostly appreciated. The pre-rendered cutscenes do tend to be a bit over the top, and some sequences, especially the ending parts, can be too melodramatic. But the scenes are so good that they become rewards for progressing further in the game. When the game gets repetitive, and it will, there's always awesome CGI stuff to look forward to. But CGI stuff is rare, since most of the cutscenes in the game use the in-game engine. I mean, this isn't a bad thing, because the in-game graphics itself also look great. It's very colorful, and it's a vibrant recreation of the Final Fantasy VII universe, which is only marred by, you know, infrequent occurrences of jaggies, but that's an issue that plagues most, if not all, other PSP titles. However, while the graphics are amazing, the actual story pushing the game forward is not all that deep. The story focuses on a rookie soldier member called Zack, who eventually becomes a mentor to Final Fantasy VII's adored protagonist, Cloud Strife. When one of the most prominent members of Soldier, I mean it's kind of like a mercenary organization, deserts the organization, Zack is called on to investigate what happened. This investigation leads to betrayals, a lot of nonsensical poetry, awkward romance between Aerith and Jack, and to a discovery of bizarre genetic experimentation. Now, the fact that they try to do this romantic sequence with Aerith and Jack is what I found kind of funny, because doesn't Cloud like have that kind of thing with Aerith? So I guess Cloud gets the leftover of his mentor, but that's another discussion for another time. Anyway, the story for the most part is pretty entertaining and has a lot of interesting pulls and twists, but in the end, one cannot help but feel that this is all just shallow fan service. Some characters are mentioned just for nostalgia factors, some events happen for no apparent reason other than to move the protagonist into the setting that Final Fantasy VII fans wanted to see in these graphics, and some lines are spoken not to further the plot, but just for the sake of having a fan-favorite character say something. Like, the guy, was it Genesis? Yeah, the lines he says, he starts reciting the poems or something. Some nonsensical poetry has absolutely no relevance to the actual plot or whatever, but he just says stuff. And I guess it's just because Final Fantasy VII fans want to see this guy say something. You know, have some screen time. That's really it. So, in a way, that's what makes this game have nothing really feels connected. And the game always kind of assumes that the player has experienced Final Fantasy VII. And to be honest, I haven't actually played Final Fantasy VII. I've only watched it played certain parts of the game, and one of my friends played it on his PC. So, a lot of the parts, I was lost. You know, I was just like, so this game expects me to kind of have a connection to this because it expects me to have played Final Fantasy VII, but I haven't. I only know some aspects of it, but I haven't. I beat my friend, beat the Emerald Weapon and the Ruby Weapon, but apparently that doesn't have anything to do with the plot, so it didn't really help me that much. So, I mean, a newcomer, yeah, could easily understand the plot, but at the same time, appreciating the story without being a fan is rather hard. Also, some parts of the game's story is hard to appreciate, even for the fans, simply because it's just too awkward and melodramatic to be taken seriously. And if you don't like the story, that's really a bad thing, because these scenes are unskippable, and you have to watch it. Even if you're on your second or third playthroughs, which I always hate it when games don't let you skip cutscenes. Unfortunately, the story and the graphics are really the best parts of Crisis Core, because the game itself is too randomized to offer a satisfying gameplay experience. Sure, attacking and using magic attacks is controllable, but RPG elements such as leveling up and using special moves depend on a random mechanic called the DMW, which is short for Digital Mind Wave. When entering a random encounter, the battle occurs in real time. There is an option to dodge or block enemy attacks, which adds a bit of strategic element to the gameplay. Attacking or using magic attack is done by selecting materials listed in the bottom right corner with the shoulder buttons, and then pressing the X button. The basic strategy of the game thus turns out to be attack a couple times, and then block or dodge when the enemy attacks, and then repeat the entire process until the enemy is defeated. Using items is done in real time too, and that can make the battle a bit hectic at times, but it is rather annoying to have to browse through items while the enemy is throwing attacks at you. Everything else depends on the slot machine, or, you know, that's what I call it, but it's actually the DMW. And the DMW is placed on the left, upper left corner of the screen. As you kill more and more enemies and meet more and more characters in the game, this slot machine randomly matches character faces. So there's character faces that, like, it's like a slot machine, really. That's the best way to put it. When three of them match, a special move is triggered. After that, numbers are randomly spun. When certain numbers match up, certain abilities are leveled up. And when three sevens are matched, Zack levels up his overall level. The DMW can be affected when Zack gets more emotional or when a special ability that increases luck is triggered. But other than that, it's mostly completely random. How you level up in the game, how you trigger special moves, and when or which monster you summon is completely dependent on the random nature of the DMW. I mean, it's a really weird design choice, but the principle is that you play enough battles and Zack will eventually trigger the DMW to level up. Though not completely random, luck is a big aspect of this game, especially since when a special move is triggered, Zack gets extra boost in his HP, SP, and or action points, which is AP, which govern non-magical abilities. It's a good thing that the game offers a lot of chances to engage in battles, since it features up to 300 optional missions. I mean, it's pretty much the same thing. You kind of go from point A to point B, defeating monsters and monsters and monsters, so the side quests feel the same, but it's there to kind of grind for you to get enough chances for the DMW to level up. So these missions are relatively simple and can be accessed at a save point. You're placed in a linear setting, like I mentioned, where you have to get to a specific enemy and defeat it. They're just opportunities to grind, really. If you could call that grinding, because of the random nature of the DMW. I mean, it's extremely simple and will become very repetitive by the 30th mission or so, but this is Crisis Core's idea of variety. Of course, some side quests do exist within the main story arc, but they're often too short and simple and doesn't require much more than walking around and looking at stuff or just pressing X. There's one instance where walking around and there's like little stuff scattered around the map, and all you have to do is kind of collect it. That's really the side quest. Whoopie-doo. So where was I? So I mean, that's really why your enjoyment of the game depends on your enjoyment of the cutscene. That's really your reward for playing this game. That's not to say the gameplay is bad, but it's not really involving and will become very repetitive very quickly. Perhaps this is why the option to replay the game in a newly unlocked hard mode is not that inviting. Counting the fact that hard mode is actually easier and more repetitive in the first playthrough, and you got a fan service that's great to watch, but not all that fun to play.